Hello everyone, good afternoon. Today I'll be talking about exploitation facilitation for Linux kernel user-free vulnerabilities. This is a joint work of University of Chinese Academy of Sciences and Penn State University. In today's talk, I will talk about exploitability evaluation for Linux kernel user-free vulnerabilities. To be specific, I will talk about the challenges in exploit development, introducing our technique, FUZE, to tackle these challenges and demonstrate its effectiveness of this approach. I'm sure you all know all software contains bugs, and the number of bugs grows with the complexity of the software. For example, an open source Linux kernel fuzzer, syscaller, has identified more than 800 of Linux kernel bugs in past 8 months. However, due to the lack of manpower, it is rare for a software development team to have enough time to fix all the bugs timely. Therefore, many software development teams use strategy to prioritize their bugs remediation efforts. For example, sometimes they prioritize bug fix based on its influence upon usability. Sometimes they fix bug based on its security implication, and sometimes they simply fix bug based on its type. Of all these strategies, the most common one is to fix bug based on its exploitability. To determine the exploitability of a bug, an analyst generally have to write a working exploit. However, for complex software, it faces several challenges. To demonstrate these challenges, let's first take a look how we exploit a real-world kernel user-free vulnerability. Assume we have the proof of concept program, and running the POC program will trigger a special execution trace and end up crashing the kernel. To write an exploit from the POC, we need to inspect the panic machine state and inspect code relevant to the panic site. If we find the panic can potentially be transformed into useful exploitable primitive, such as control flow hijack, or arbitrary memory write, then we can continue exploit development. To do that, we need to identify the site of dangling point occurrence and that of dangling pointer dereference. In addition, we also pinpoint the system call corresponding to the two sites as well as the freed object. With this info in hand, we can easily pinpoint the time window to perform heap spray. To do that, we need to perform heap spray, we need to carefully select a kernel object, spray it to the spot of the freed object. In this process, we also need to find the system call and adjust its parameters so we can perform a successful heap spray. It is not difficult to observe in the whole process of the exploitation. The first challenge for us is we need to put extensive manual effort in analyzing the kernel panic and tracking down this critical information previously mentioned. With this energy devoted, our second challenge is we need extensive expertise in kernel. As I mentioned earlier, we need to inspect all kernel objects for suitable candidates and find a system call to allocate such objects, and figure out a proper way to perform effective heap spray. To perform such exploit, we need deep understanding of the Linux kernel. Assume we have extensive knowledge of target software Linux kernel, and also willing to put significant effort to analyze the kernel panic, it is still hard to perform ultimate exploitation. This is because we also need to, we need security expertise to find a proper approach to, for example, crafting an RLP attack or crafting shellcode based on a current execution context. Over the past decades, as you see here, there are a lot of work tackling these challenges I mentioned above. For example, to tackle the second challenge and better manipulate heap layout for heap exploitation, people have proposed techniques such as heap spray, heap feng shui, and recently people proposed an automated approach with regression test case to help shape heap layout for exploitation. In addition, in another research line, people put a lot of efforts into automatic exploit generation. For example, in Cyber Grand Challenge, a great tool, Anger, is open source and shows its effectiveness in generating exploits against simple vulnerabilities such as Stack Overflow and format string. However, after talking to security researchers and white hat hackers, they still complain. Writing exploits takes them a lot of time. Since I play CTFs with my team, usually we can barely sleep in a CTF game up to two days and keep reversing the target program and writing exploits. To make life easier and free us from the tedious work and of developing exploits, I decided to look into this issue where we still put a lot of effort generating exploits for kernel user free vulnerability. Therefore, in the rest part of my talk, I will talk about another challenge hidden behind their complaint, introduce our technique, and demonstrate its utility in real-world exploitation. To show you this hidden challenge, let's first take a look at the POC of real-world vulnerability. Here, on the right-hand side, is a code fragment of the POC program. As we can see, there is an infinite loop. Within this loop, it creates a thread, task 1. Task 1 will cause set soc opt. Every time this system call is invoked, a new object is allocated and added to the linked list. At the end of the loop, there is another system call close. Every time this system call is invoked, the newly added object will be removed from the linked list. As we can see in this infinite loop, in addition to task 1, there is another thread, task 2, invoking system call bind. Together with task 1, it creates a risk condition. The risk condition will make the system call close fail to remove the newly added object from the linked list and leaves a dangling pointer behind. In the next iteration of this loop, system call set soc opt will be invoked one more time. As a result, a new node will be created and added to the linked list. In this case, as we can see in the list add operation, the dangling pointer gives us the power to modify the memory region in green. Since we have no control above the address of the newly created object and the address of the previously freed object, it is a primitive of writing unmanageable data to unmanageable address. Apparently, it is difficult to use the primitive in the POC to perform a successful exploitation, considering this is also a risk condition bug. However, we cannot simply draw the conclusion that the vulnerability is unexploitable. As you can see here, if we insert a system call send message with proper parameters after system call close, we are able to dereference the vulnerable object in a different way and potentially obtain a primitive of directly hijacking the instruction pointer. We all know control flow hijack is usually a better primitive than the previously unmanageable write primitive in exploitation. Intuitively, if we can find different ways of dereferencing a dangling pointer, we can potentially find more exploitable primitives. To facilitate UAF exploitation by finding more ways of dereferencing the vulnerable object and identifying exploitable primitive, we design and implement a prototype system fuse. We design fuse to find more exploitable primitives for kernel user-free exploitation. I will introduce a high-level idea of how fuse works step by step. Fuse facilitates kernel UAF exploitation generation in three steps. And the first step is critical information extraction. During the execution of the POC program, we need to identify both sides of dangling pointer occurrence and the dereference, and to find the time window in order to correctly deploy heap spread. We need to pinpoint the corresponding system calls, which is indicated by system call A and system call B in the right-hand side control flow graph. To do that, we combine both F-trace and case and log to perform a log analysis to extract this information. You can refer to our paper for that part. After we have this critical information, the second step of FUZE is performing kernel fuzzing during the correct time window extracted by previous step. Instead of executing the original system call in the POC, we try all kinds of system calls right after dangling pointer occurrence. Fuzzing at such context may trigger different dereference of the dangling pointer. Hopefully, we can find another system call dereferencing the vulnerable object, as indicated by system call M on the right-hand side figure. System call M also dereferences the object, but in a different way. By performing kernel fuzzing, we can learn different ways of dereferencing the dangling pointer, which increase the probability of discovering useful exploitable primitives. We use syscaller for such kernel fuzzing. Having found different sites of dangling pointer dereference by kernel fuzzing, the last step of FUZE is symbolic execution. By symbolically executing the code near the dangling pointer dereference site, we may find exploitable primitives and generate exploits using identified primitive. Using the identified system call M, we kick in symbolic execution before the first instruction, which will dereference the dangling pointer. We set symbolic value for each byte in the freed object. After initialization, we symbolically exploit program state. During the symbolic execution, we check for predefined exploitable primitives and try to generate exploits with them. During symbolic execution, we use custom concretization strategy to handle symbolic read and write operations. We tackle state explosion by limiting the length of a pass and the time of entering a loop. During symbolic execution, we will check for exploitable primitives. We define a lot of exploitable primitives and check for them based on current machine state and the semantic of a current instruction. And the most common primitive is the unconstrained state. By unconstrained, we mean the instruction pointer is symbolic pointer, or it is a callback with a symbolic function pointer. To develop exploits using such primitive, we may check whether we can constrain the instruction pointer to certain gadget. For example, if we can direct the instruction pointer to the stack pivot gadget, we can potentially bypass SMEP protection by executing the RP payload in user space. On the other hand, if we can constrain the instruction pointer to a function gadget to overwrite CR4 register, we can potentially bypass SMAP mitigation by firstly disabling. Besides control flow hijack, we also have other types of primitives. Due to the time constraint, we will not talk about other exploit primitives such as double free and write what where primitives. Now let's take a look how this technique can be utilized in real-world kernel user-free exploitation. As you can see in the right-hand side figure, there are 15 kernel user-free vulnerabilities. We collect some famous user-free bugs, as well as some bugs without any public exploit. The first two columns indicate the number of exploits we found on the internet. There are only 5 vulnerabilities have demonstrated their exploitability against SMEP. And only 2 vulnerabilities has demonstrated their exploitability against the SMAP. In the last two columns, we can see the number of exploits generated by our system. Under the assistance of FUZE, more exploits are generated. We are able to find exploitable primitives and exploit more vulnerabilities to bypass SMEP protection. These vulnerabilities does not have any exploits in the wild. We can also generate SMAP bypassing exploits for two vulnerabilities. This means our technique could help researchers to identify more exploitation primitives, which further gives them the ability to bypass widely deployed security mitigations. In addition, this also means we could diversify an exploit. By diversify an exploit, we mean we can exploit the same vulnerability with different system calls. This is important because antiviral products uses a pattern of system call to catch attacks based on the vulnerability. With the diversity of the system call, someone may bypass this detection or mitigation. For those failure cases, the reason behind varies. For some cases, the reason is the dangling pointer occurrence and dereference sites are in the same system call. There is not enough time to perform heap spread. For some cases, we found a dominant which will panic the kernel before we can reach any exploitable primitives. For example, CVE-2015-3636 and CVE-2017-7374. Both of these bugs will dereference an invalid address before reaching exploitable primitive. For other cases, we were not able to generate any exploits. If you are able to develop a working exploit towards these vulnerabilities, please let me know. In conclusion, primitive identification and security mitigation bypass can influence exploitability. Even if a PoC program does not provide a promising exploitable primitive, we cannot draw a negative conclusion about the exploitability. And existing exploitation research fails to provide facilitation to tackle these two challenges. In our prototype system, the combination of fuzzing and symbolic execution has a great potential towards tackling these challenges. Research on exploit automation is just the beginning of the game. There are still more challenges waiting for us to tackle. For example, it is a future direction to generate exploits for more complex vulnerability type, such as kernel heap overflow. To help further research about kernel exploitation and automation of exploitation, the source code of FUZE, as well as the exploits generated with its assistance, are available on GitHub in case you are interested. This is the end of my talk. Thank you for your attention, and I'm ready to take questions.
Thank you, great talk. Just a quick question about the exploits generated. Did you perhaps try running them multiple times to see how reliable they were? Or did you just check if they worked once?
Yeah. The stability varies for different vulnerabilities. For some vulnerability, for example, if there is not a risk condition or the vulnerable object size belongs to a stable slab catch, the exploit will be very stable, like more than 90% of a successful ratio. For some risk conditions, because the heap layout is not very stable, the success ratio is not that high, maybe only 15% of success ratio.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Do you mind if I ask another question? Have you considered applying the same approach to web browsers, and can you think of any ideas why it might or might not work?
I think the high-level idea is applicable, but to tackle web browsers, we need to analyze the heap allocator. For example, some browser will have heap isolation or some delayed reuse to mitigate user-free exploitation. So the problem is whether we can achieve a stable heap spread or heap layout manipulation. Thank you.
Any other questions? Well, let's thank our speaker again. You can come up and ask questions.